Yeah, welcome everybody. It's always amazing to see so many people about a technical dry topic like open API specs. We figured in the beginning of the year that it might be good to have a talk about that. So originally I had my colleague from Google, Mehdi. We came up with a talk, but he couldn't make it, so I'm alone here today. But we had the idea open API gets much more important. And we planned at the time in the beginning of the year that we want to do a lot of work in this direction. And as it turned out, we did. So there's a group of a handful of people actively working on that at the moment. And we will see a lot of news in 1.15 and 1.16. Yeah, everybody has seen, I guess, the agenda. I just skip that very quickly. Just one word about the two terms, specs and schema. I think I say schema today, but it's the same thing. So for our purpose here, just assume they are the same thing. First of all, a question into the audience. Who has written OpenAPI like that manually? Quite a number of hands. Who is using a tool for that? Even less. So I think a lot of people know OpenAPI briefly. So here's an example how we use that. So on the left side, you have an example. It's a project with some types, some API types, example structs, and usual spec and status. And those are translated into OpenAPI, into a specification, a schema on the right side, and you put that into a CRD. I think most of you will know that. This OpenAPI was pretty much unrestricted up to now. And we noticed that you can define pretty crazy types using OpenAPI, which are far from being normal in the Kubernetes ecosystem. So we try to think about what are natural types in Kubernetes? What is a type which conforms to API conventions, which we wrote down somewhere in the documentation? And how does this look like in OpenAPI? And I want to start to introduce some intuition. So on the left side, you have structs, just structs. On the right side, you have more than structs. So you still have properties and the fields. So this corresponds mainly with everything on the left side. But you also have something, we call it now value validation. So it's more than just structure. There are things like required fields. They're not about structure. You can check them afterwards, after checking the structure of an object, of a JSON blob you get in a request. You can define things like minimal length of a string or a slice. You can even have logic. There's any of, one of, and not. So real propositional logic inside embedded into OpenAPI. And this is pretty advanced and goes far beyond what we have on the left side in the Golang types. And this value validation makes things complicated. So I have an example in a minute about any of how this really makes it hard to understand what the spec really means. What we are mostly interested in when we move CRDs forward is the structure. We don't care about length of strings or some regular expressions which match strings. We care about structure. And if you look in the core types or the types which are in Kubernetes natively implemented in Go, they follow a very simple structure. You hardly have something like called polymorphism, where a field can either be a string or it can be an int or it can be something else. We don't have that. We're very down to earth, and every field has just a type. And here's one example. So if you look at the example here, the struct, this pretty much one-to-one corresponds to the structural validation OpenAPI schema. Maybe it's not enough for you because you want more value validation in addition, but for API machinery, for the implementation of features in the API server, we really care about that, right? But we had a hard time to get this purely structural validation from your provided schemas because it was just arbitrary. We will come to that in a second. As a sum up, so we provide OpenAPI v3 schemas in CRDs, and traditionally they are just put in spec validation, but we have versions today. You can also have one schema per version in addition. Everything follows V3 Open API specification with some restrictions and some extensions, but mostly it's just Open API V3. We publish those Open API specs, so we have an endpoint of the Kube API server. It's called Open API V2. And kubectl downloads that on every request. So if you say kubectl get something, usecd, it will make a request to the API server and ask for the specification. It did that for the last versions, but there was nothing. CRD's schemas were not published. We changed that in 1.15. So in 1.15, we publish Open API schemas. So from the validation schemas in the spec, we publish that to kubectl, which means kubectl will do it will do explain, so you can ask what is this CRD, how does it look like, this custom resource, which fields does it have, and it will do client-side validation. So that's already a step which makes it much more natural compared to native Golang types. Structural validation. The structural term is really the core of the talk. You will see it's very important for the future of CRDs. So we had the structural validation, so I gave this example, and I added something called complete here. So complete means from the structure, we not only know the structure, like all the field names, we also know the types. So for every field, for every item, for everything which is structurally specified somehow, if there's a type as well, just one type, not two, then we call it complete. And we will expect that from specifications in the future. There are specifications which look like that. So I said we have logic. We have propositional logic inside. AnyAuth is just like an OR in propositional logic. And you can say something like AnyAuth, and then you have two schemas, both properties. Both have the schedule, the string here in the spec. And we have different patterns. That's perfectly fine. So you can express some real date following some ISO standard, or you can have just a timestamp, but in a string. That's fine. But we also have type here. And type somewhere below logic, inside of this logical whatever construct. And this makes it very hard to reason about that. So I said, if we want to go forward with CRDs and provide more features, we always have to understand the structure and all the types. If the API server sees something like that, it has to understand the semantics of Open API very deeply. And you can express very, very crazy things, it's very, very hard or even impossible, I think, to really extract the structural schema. So what we do, or what we request, restrict in the API, we want that those type definitions go outside of logic. So below any of, one off, all off, and not. Types must not be defined. Everything must be outside. So we just move that, it's fine. So just by moving that outside, we have the structure separated from logic, from value validation. And if we do that for all fields in the structure, we call the structural schema. And the idea is just, you can see it here in this animation, we can just strip the value validation very easily just by removing something from the spec. The structure is obvious. And the code in the API server which processes the structure is very, very simple. It doesn't have to evaluate propositional logic or anything possible in Open API. So structural schema. So structural schema is a keyword. It's an official property in the API starting from 1.15. We added a condition, and it's called non-structural schema. It will tell you the evaluations. So you specified something. It's Open API. It conforms to what we allowed all the time since we have this validation schema in CRDs. But there are violations which make this schema somehow complicated to handle, non-structural. And you get this condition on the CRD. It's not harmful. It's just information for you. So start with a 1.15 cluster when it's out and just create your CRD and check that this condition doesn't appear. If it appears, you have a list of violations, and you should think either about your schema, maybe you can just easily fix it, or maybe even about types. It might be that your types, your API definitions are so complicated that they were valid before, but they don't conform what we want to have to move forward with CIDs. So it's a kind of, yeah, technically it's not a working change, so we expect something more. But we still allow everything which we had before. It's not structural, you always get this bit of ugly condition. But everything which you have now, which is not structural, will keep working. So even when we publish the V1 CID maybe later this year, you can still have your old CIDs as long as you create them in V1 Beta 1. But they're even working with V1. So everything keeps working, so don't panic. Everything is fine. And maybe if anybody fears his special construction doesn't work, I'm open for questions. I want to hear examples where this really is important. Maybe there are some situations like that. We have conversion, we have CID conversion, which we promote to beta in 1.15. So there is a way out. So even for those special cases, conversion is a way out. So much about the motivation and the intuition behind structural schema. So here's a cap. At the moment, it's the only documentation for that. But of course, for 1.15, we will officially document that. But this cap covers all the details. If you're interested into that, just look into the enhancement repository. We have a couple of more caps. So I really said there are many news about CIDs, and you see them here. So we are hard at work adding. I already talked about publishing. So we publish CID schemas on this OpenAPI V2 endpoint, which means kubectl will understand CIDs and explain, and it will client-side do checks. We have conversion webhooks, which is alpha at the moment, but we promote that to 1.15 to beta. We have something called pruning. I talked about that a year ago, I think, the first time. We really have that. It's merged, so in 1.15 we will have that. Probably we'll get defaulting. It's implemented and under review at the moment, but this will be alpha, so needs at least one more revision to merge. There's something about unions. Everybody knows unions from volumes. You know this volume source thing where there are, 50 different volume types. That's a union, and there's a lot of work going on at the moment, also for native types around unions, and CIDs should also participate in that. OpenAPI, I saw the hands in the beginning. A lot of people write them manually. There is support in KubeBuilder, so KubeBuilder has a number of tags, or markers, how they call them today, to specify OpenAPI specs, and there's an effort to standardize that and even use the same tags inside of Kubernetes native types. And the overall theme is we want to go GA with CIDs. So we want to have V1 API extensions, including CIDs, obviously. So structural schema is central. Everything you see here, everything new depends on being structural. So if you have this non-structural condition in your CID, try to fix it, because if you want to participate in new features, you have to fix those issues. A bit bigger picture, OpenAPI consumers. So we have a couple of producers of OpenAPI. We saw the hands in the beginning. We consume OpenAPI in a number of places. So we do client-side validation. That's what you will see in 1.15 with your CIDs. Explain, I said, we generate clients from OpenAPI. Now, when we publish it, you can also generate CID clients from OpenAPI V2, so from the exported schema. Doc generation works, so CID docs become much easier. And there are more places where we use them. So IntelliJ, this Golang IDE, has support for OpenAPI and can do completion, auto-completion. That's pretty cool. This might work soon with CIDs. And then we have the features inside of the Kube API server. So on the left side, we have server-side validation. That's what we have for, I know, 7 releases or so. Pruning, defaulting, I will talk in a second. And maybe in the future, we are thinking about protobuf support, which might be related to OpenAPI, and more features like read-only fields is a request we get to query very often, that you can really specify this field can never be changed after creation of a CID. This is possible with structural schema. It's not implemented, there's no cap, but it's pretty obvious how to do. Explain looks like that. So in OpenShift, we moved a prominent example, security context constraints, to CID, into a CID. And you can just ask kubectl explain your CID, and you get this nice print out of all the fields. And you can dive down into subfields. And it's just much more native than it was before. A few words about OpenAPI publishing. We publish V2, but we define in CIDs V3. A lot of you might not have looked into details what this means. Here's an example. On the left, you have a pretty complex, not complex, but I mean, it hardly fits on the slide, specification of an object. Foo bar, foo is a string, bar is whatever. It's greater or equal to 42, and yeah, there's some any of some properties, and foo is easy, bar is not that easy. So we come back to that in a second. But if we publish that, there is no any of in V2. And that's a picture of the data flow. So you're probably somewhere here, so you define your types. Maybe you manually, or use KubeBuilder, you manually write specs, so they are here. And then V3 is converted to V2, and this goes to KubeCuttle. So KubeCuttle will only see V2, not V3, which means everything which is V3 only, not supported by V2, we have to strip. And this is what happens here. There is no any of in V2. So this goes away. The whole nice specification just is not visible in the output of the API server. It's not visible, so you lose something like the pattern here. You lose the max min length of the string. But even worse, you lose that, well, foo is a string, but bar is a, might be an integer, or it might be a string. But if it's a string, it has, yeah, go away. Max length is, min length is 1, and max length is 0, which is a contradiction, obviously. So there is no string which fulfills that. We, as humans, we can derive, well, it can never be a string. It's always an integer, right? So it's a different example here where we don't want types below any of, because if we have them, we lose the type. We don't have a type here. The type is practically undefined. And kubectl cannot do anything, cannot complain when you create an object that this type is wrong, because the type is not specified from the view of kubectl. So same thing again. We want to move the types outside. So this is one reason why the structural schema is so important for publishing, because if we do that, we suddenly have the type here. So it's structural complete again. We lose something like value validation, but that's fine. It's not, I mean, kubectl doesn't evaluate the min lengths and the max lengths anyway, so we don't lose much. Some words. So mix of types and logic, we never want that. And this is an example of polymorphic types. So it's either an integer or it's a string. Question to the audience, who has types which use int or string, this predefined type in Kubernetes? Some hands. So good news, we support that. But it's the only thing we support with polymorphism. So anything like int or bool, int or object, no, doesn't work. If you want that, do discriminated unions like the volumes do. That's a formal or the official way to do that in API types. So we have a structural schema now on the right side. Perfect. Just one slide about expressivity. No? Yeah. Everybody knows you cannot express everything in OpenAPI. There are limits. And here are two examples. and we don't change that. So at the moment, those limits exist. I have two types here. One is the unique associative list. Containers are an example inside of pods, so those names are unique, right? Everybody knows that. If you write them, if you have the same name for the container, kubectl create will reject that. But actually, it's API server which does the validation and rejects that. We cannot express that at the moment. Maybe we'll do it in the future with some kind of invariant, but OpenAPI cannot do it. That's why we also cannot do it. Similar thing, existence. So if you reference a volume mount here, and there must be a volume in addition, of course, with the same name, you can express that. This doesn't change. If you want something like that, the only way to do it at the moment and in the near future is admission. So you can write admission webhooks, and of course, they can do everything. So much about consumers. On the other side, there are producers. So we have Kube Open API. Everybody who writes aggregated API servers might know that. In Kube itself, we do that. And controller tools, as I said, has support. So controller tools is a sub-repository of Kube Builder and also Operator SDK. And there's a controller gen, and this can create your schema just by parsing your types, some markers, and you get a CID manifest at the end. There's work about having a less opinionated tool called CID Schema Gen, but on the same code base. So there's a PR which we did. This came out from the OpenShift work, where we also use CIDs everywhere nowadays. And this will eventually merge, hopefully, in the next days, weeks, whatever. And this is a tool where you can just give it types and CID manifests, and it adds the schema. So very simple, just two arguments, two packages if you want, or two directories, and it does its work. Pretty easy, easy to use, and less opinionated than everything around KubeBuilder. But it's, the goal is to really use the same base. So the markers are the same, the tags are the same. You can use CID schema gen if you don't have a Kube builder based operator, controller, or whatever. And of course, you can still manually write those schemas. So here are some examples. We haven't seen that. Some examples of those markers. So we have optional for a long time already. It's evaluated by Kube builder today. We have something that's new in 1.14, nullable. Some of you might have seen this problem that they have types like time. Meta v1 time, it converts into null if it's empty. And you cannot do anything about it. Nullable allows that. And there are many more. So everything you know from OpenAPI, there's a corresponding marker in KubeBuilder and in the CID schema gen as well. And we're working on unifying that with native API tabs as well as a goal. And yeah, I talked about that already. So it's really easy. The idea is just to have two parameters, your API packages with dot, 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 like Golang syntax, and one directory with your manifest, manually written maybe, and it just replaces schemas, nothing else. It keeps everything in order, so the files look the same, but they have the schema nicely generated. The last part is about pruning. So I talked about that a year ago already. We get pruning. I just show it, I think, and it's pretty obvious what it means. You have a schema here in the middle, and it's complete, so we know everything which is allowed in the API is specified, right? Which means everything which is not specified is some garbage. We better don't want to persist in etcd. That's the basic idea here. So everything in red here on the left, it's not specified, so the Kube API server will just throw it away, because you specified a complete schema, and we know everything about the API. For some of those, like conditions, it's not so critical. I mean, who cares about conditions? But there might be security-related things, like somebody just puts a Boolean for privileged, and you don't have privilege in your API today, but maybe tomorrow. And somebody could set this field today. It's written to etcd, and then you update your CID schema, and suddenly there is one object with this privilege. And you have never checked that, neither validation nor anything else, like admission, which checks permissions, for example. And suddenly there's an object never validated, and it's privileged. So it's a security thing. You don't want that. And this pruning will help. It's configured pretty easily. There's just one flag in specs, preserve unknown fields. If it's true, which is default for v1, beta1, nothing changes. So if you just create your CID in a 1.15 cluster, you will see there is this preserve unknown fields, but it's true. Doesn't hurt, nothing changes. We plan to change that into, so we want to default it to false in v1. Like, this means we enable pruning in v1. You can still opt out in v1, beta1, but we want to forbid that in v1. So again, don't panic. There are ways out. You just have to be explicit about them. And they're written here at the bottom. So we have some vendor extensions for API, OpenAPI, which allow to opt out. So you can say ex-Kubernetes preserve unknown fields too, and then everything below the specification is not pruned. It's raw JSON as before, but you must be explicit. That's the goal here. And with that, you can formulate raw extension. So some of you will have embedded objects using raw extension, and there is an embedded resource boolean which you can also define, and then you get open meta object meta validation for free. So everybody who has tried to specify object meta in embedded objects, don't do it. No need anymore. This gives you automatic validation. You can have just raw JSON interface, anonymous interface, basically. You can even use it at the root of your object. So in theory, you can have no. So there's no pruning. It's just a JSON blob as we had it until now. So it's still possible, but be explicit about it. And as I said, if you have int or string, so this predefined type we have in Kubernetes, there is another vendor extension if this overlay goes away. Ex-Kubernetes int or string true. It's the only polymorphism we allow. And of course, this will not be published correctly. So in OpenAPI v2, you won't have a type because the type is polymorphic. This cannot be expressed in v2 OpenAPI, so it has limits, but it's possible to specify. Yeah, so this is a near future. So 1.15 will get a lot of new features around CIDs. Publishing, it's enabled by default. You can try it out in 1.14, but there's a feature gate at the moment. But anyway, try it. That's a suggestion. In client-side validation, we complain about typos in fields and unspecified things in general. So if your schema is incomplete, kubectl create will complain. It's like with if you create a pod and you use a feature from very modern Kubernetes, but you have an old cluster, kubectl will complain. That's how we do client-side validation today. It's a user interface of client-side validation, and the same applies here for Kubernetes for CIDs. Conversion webhooks will be promoted, so you can finally have conversions with webhooks in every cluster which has beta features switch on. Pruning is beta directly in 1.15, so. You can just use it, set this preserve unknown fields to false and get pruning. Try it, report issues, and report, as I said before, if you have APIs which maybe do not fit in this structural schema thing, I'm happy to hear about examples. And defaulting in alpha for 1.15. And unions, probably, there's work, but I don't think in 1.15 you will get much. Let's take a look. So we have, so just a last word about defaulting. So defaulting will look like that. You can have defaults for fields just in OpenAPI. There's default anyway in OpenAPI. We never evaluated that, and I think we even rejected that. So, but you can add it now, and you get the expected defaulting. So the 100 is put in if you have an empty object, you send, suddenly the values are set. The same thing if something is in etcd already, an old object, and you add the default, and somebody reads the object, magically the field is suddenly set. So it's a pretty cool feature if you introduce new fields. We have that in native types for ages, and you get that with CRDs, at least in alpha in 1.15. Yeah, and so I dared to put some version here. So we are trying to go to GA in one of the next versions. So GA means V1 API extensions. So we are optimistic to make that. So far about the future. I'm open for questions.
Hi. So I have one question regarding to rejecting unknown fields on the spec. If I post a pod, if I'm not mistaken, it rejects the pod if there are unknown fields there. Is there something planned for CRDs?
So if I understand correctly, there's additional properties, this thing in OpenAPI. You can, in C, we set it to false. But server-side, we never reject fields.
Okay, so it's purely kubectl?
Kubectl will do it because clients are validation is like that. It's done for every native type as well, and the same for CRDs. Okay. So kubectl will complain.
Okay.
So typos, that's the most important thing. Typos and field names are finally seen by kubectl.
Okay. Thank you.
A quick reminder, please remember to rate the talk on Sketch.
How does this initiative reflect on the native Kubernetes types? So the ones that are not CRDs.
Which one of the initiatives? So pruning we have forever. It's kind of an artifact of Golang unmarshalling of the JSON decoder. So we have it forever. The only thing which really applies here, I mean, unions is a thing for native types as well. There is work being done to make that more natural with the discriminator field, so we can talk about that in a break. And the unified Golang API tags, this is also something we want to see, that you can import a pod spec and this whole generation just works, right? That's the idea.
Hi. I don't know if you're familiar with the operator SDK. I hope so. But how much of this, if I generate an operator today, is already in there? And what do I have to do if I generated something already to update?
Yeah, so I'm not up to date how far controller tools is used. Maybe somebody from Operator SDK is here. I'm interested in this as well, so we can discuss that. Controller tools and controller runtime, they are shared. That's my runtime is now shared already, and tools should be shared. So there should be something generic about or throughout the whole ecosystem. So I'm not sure how far they are, so I'm not the right person to ask that. But if somebody later on is here, please answer that.
With the move to the open API spec and unions, are there plans now with custom resource definitions to support custom sub-resources and verbs at some point?
Many people want that, and I think I just can refer to the deep dive. There's an API machine deep dive on Thursday, and I saw a slide about that, so that's the right place to discuss that, I guess. There are ideas what to do, how to do it.
Thank you.
Okay, I think we have time for one more.
Does the auto-generation stuff descend into native types like persistent volume claim templates, for example? And also, is it clever enough to understand about enumerations?
enumerations, it's an interesting topic. There's an API convention document where it's discussed. It's not completely clear how to do it, whether it's a good thing to have, like complete enumeration, because this might change in versions, in different versions. So at the moment, there's nothing planned. But you have seen we have introduced a number of those ex-Kubernetes vendor extensions, and we are much more open to add those tags now. So if maybe, yeah, and there's nothing planned at least.
It's a dynamic
ambition. Hmm?
Sorry.
So if you want anything like that, it wants to go in the dynamic ambition controller then.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you can write a pattern nowadays. This works, but it's ugly. It's an API convention discussion, I guess. Yeah, thank you, everybody. If you have questions or examples, just talk to me.